step to get V3, okay, as a function of V2 that we got, which multiplied by a ratio. The ratio is something that we measure in the wind tunnel between V3 and V2. So by doing that, we kind of, you know, compare the results, and that's the slide that, you know, shows, if you like, the error that we have here. This slide for three particular months, August, September, and October 2013, is when we did the measurements, shows the comparison between the total wind energy that one predicts, anticipates, by using the estimated approach, this one here, and through the wind tunnel test, and this one here shows what is the field measurement as shown. The comparison is very good, the error, the discrepancy is of the order of 5%. Now, that was, of course, the good case, because this is the homogeneous terrain. Now, we did exactly the same thing for the non-homogeneous terrain, where, of course, the results cannot be expected to be that good. Nevertheless, yes, there is a bigger error here. The error is in the order of 20%, as expected. But nevertheless, for preliminary design purposes, this is something to kind of, you know, be used and considered. So it's an approach that we recommend as a good one to kind of, you know, get an initial estimation of the wind resource assessment. So now I'm going to the second topic, which is the wind turbine designs. And here, of course, we have to take a number of things into consideration. It's going to be a more detailed paper presented, as I said, later this morning, that is going to give more details of this work, but I would like to present the overview here. So there are a number of factors to be considered, starting from the aerodynamic shape of the blade, the location, very important, where I'm going to put the wind turbine or turbines, the power that I'm going to generate, which of course depends on flow characteristics, density, speed, and turbulence. But, of course, for every design, there are a number of constraints. Structural design, we heard yesterday in our professional papers on dealing with fatigue and vibration problems, size constraints that we have, noise limitation, particularly in the urban environment, visual disturbances, and the problem with low startup wind speeds. People are very much against urban wind energy. This is the main argument that they use. Basically, the wind speeds are low there. And we say, yes, they are low, but we're trying to kind of, you know, make some effort to kind of increase them artificially in very good. Now, possible designs, of course, classical, the horizontal axis and the vertical axis. The horizontal axis wind turbines are the most well known and most widespread. Blades are always rotating perpendicularly to the wind, but as we know, they perform poorly when you change the wind direction, the wind direction changes, and of course, they do not cope well with turbulent buffeting that it is available plenty, you know, in downtown areas. Now, the vertical axis wind turbines suit much better to urban applications. They respond better to turbulence, multi-directional winds. They have lower noise and they are more aesthetically pleasing. All of this could be subjective. And you see here some typical examples of vertical axis wind turbines and some actual kind of, you know, applications of urban wind energy and the various kind of, you know, groups that we have here. Small wind turbines on top of buildings, self-standing wind turbines in public areas, and building integrated wind turbines, which I would like to talk for more in particular, the IWT, that I think they are probably the most popular, they will be the most popular ones. And this is a classical table, you have seen that probably before, but I think it's a good one. It shows the advantages and disadvantages of various types of wind turbines, horizontal axis, the lift-based vertical axis, the drag-based vertical axis as well, as to what is kind of efficient, what is not, and so on. So you have all the characterization here about efficiency and various other parameters. Now, this is an excellent research work that I took from Professor Panini, was published a couple of years ago. And I like this work because it's very nice and clean, as I call it, very clear. It shows the kind of, you know, difference between the performance of the vertical axis and the horizontal axis wind turbine. And you can see the turbines there, the locations on the Harbor. And of course, we had two distinct regimes. In the regime, we have low turbulence when the wind blows from the sea, and we have high turbulence when the wind blows from the land. And then that shows, this is a nice clear slide, that shows really the actual power coefficient produced in both cases in a period of 8 months, as you can see here, from the two different turbines that we have here. And you can see clearly here that the horizontal axis of the turbine performed generally kind of, you know, lower in comparison to the vertical axis of the turbine, which is very consistent with what we said before. So, for these reasons now, that thermal wind power has attracted attention more recently, there are of course questions, as I mentioned already, about the power output performance in urban areas, and that's where we would like kind of, you know, concentrate on new designs with higher power efficiency, and we are working on this in this area. And these are some examples here of bringing diffuser structures in order to envelope rooftop or vertical axis wind turbine that has been kind of, you know, popular, if you like. This is some work from Japan, where again they use a diffuser shroud with a broad ring flange at the exit periphery, so that so the wind turbine is inside in order to again improve the performance. And in fact, there have been some very kind of, you know, interesting improvements that of course depend on the particular case and so on. This is a case where you have some field data, which is very good. You have the case of bare wind tunnel data, and you see the difference, particularly for high wind speeds, as to if you use a diffuser embedded wind turbine, DAWT we call it, then you have some kind of 4 to 5 times kind of, you know, better performance, as you see here. I think high wind speeds here is very low, and so on, but this is something that is quite promising, and we're doing some work in this area. Last but not least, I would like to talk about urban building aerodynamics. And of course, I start with a classical slide, how the velocity profile changes with the roughness, and with a simplified table coming from the earliest work from Delaware, 1960, and so on, that we have some kind of, you know, parameters for the gradient height, power flow exponent, and so on, for different exposures. We look, of course, into an energy with topographic effects, and this is a slide that appears in a lot of national and international wind codes and standards, which basically shows the speed up that one expects to get on the top of a hill or an escarpment or something like that. We have equations, tables, and so on for designing to calculate that and see what it is. And there is interesting information available, you know, to do some preliminary design as to what the wind resources are. Now, topographic effects are very important, and again, this is a work that happened previously, and they were kind of a lot of experiments in Texas Tech University in the United States, and this is work that Chris Lesworth did by using different kinds of profiles of topography, different slopes for ridges, escarpments, and so on, and he produced kind of velocity profiles, velocity amplification factors for the different cases so that one could use in order to proceed, as I said, with the preliminary design. This is another kind of, you know, diagram of canyon vortex phenomena, so that we can see what the vortex behavior is when you have a wind perpendicular to two buildings that are parallel, and there is a gap between those, or we have a corner eddy that develops there, canyon vortex, and so on. So these are areas where kind of potentially people would like to place wind turbines, and we have to see what the situation is going to be. So there is negative influence and there is positive influence in urban areas when we have high turbulence and the wind coming from multiple directions, as we know, then that's negative. When you look at the velocity and the density of their flow that increases in some urban areas, of course this is a positive influence, and we try to take advantage of that. Last but not least, we would like to kind of, you know, use the so-called, as I said before, building integrated wind turbines, where you have to consider factors like the effect of the surroundings and wind conditions of the turbines, the effect of wind conditions on optimal placement where we're going to put them on the building envelope, and of course we have to try to get an accurate prediction of the wind power output. And there have been a number of kind of ideas about where you can put the turbines and how they're going to work. And this is a nice sketch about that, obviously a year or two ago. And I would like to concentrate on the well-known main World Trade Center towers that I believe they are operational. And you can see there the location is the edge of the Arabian Gulf. And we have twin towers there of 240 meters height. And that was completed in 2008. It cost about at that time $150 million. And it is considered to be the world's first skyscraper with integrated wind turbines. Now, yesterday afternoon, we had a very interesting presentation on some of the studies on that. But I have taken the results of this work from the chair of the session research here. And I think that quite interesting. It was also mentioned yesterday that perhaps a different kind of location or a different configuration of the turbines would really lead to some improvement in what one gets in terms of wind energy. But that was too late. So my respected chair here had demonstrated in a very interesting paper that the converted kind of configuration